Macmillan Audio presents Code Red by E.J. Dionne Jr. Narrated for you by Adam Barr.
For members of the rising generations who will restore our democracy, including James, Julia, and Margot, and my students and interns, and for those in the older generation ready to lend them a hand. This world demands the qualities of youth, not a time of life, but a state of mind, a temper of the will, a quality of the imagination, a predominance of courage over timidity, of the appetite for adventure over the life of ease. Robert F. Kennedy. And in grateful memory of Cokie Roberts, David Broder, Flora Lewis, and Michael Harrington. Introduction. The opportunity we dare not miss. The uprising against Trump and the rendezvous with dignity. Will progressives and moderates feud while America burns? Or will these natural allies take advantage of a historic opportunity to strengthen American democracy and defeat an increasingly radical form of conservatism? The choice in our politics is that stark. This book is offered in a spirit of hope, but with a sense of alarm. My hope is inspired by the broad and principled opposition that Donald Trump's presidency called forth. It is a movement that can and should be the driving force in our politics long after Trump is gone. His abuses of office, his divisiveness, his bigotry, his autocratic habits, and his utter lack of seriousness about the responsibilities of the presidency drew millions of previously disengaged citizens to the public square and the ballot box. The danger he represented inspired young Americans to participate in our public life at unprecedented levels. Tens of thousands of Americans, especially women, have gathered in libraries, diners, and church basements to share wisdom, to organize, and in many cases, to run for office themselves. These newly engaged citizens have created an opportunity to build a broad alliance for practical and visionary government as promising as any since the Great Depression gave Franklin Roosevelt the chance to build the New Deal coalition. To seize this opening, progressives and moderates must realize that they are allies who have far more in common than they sometimes wish to admit. They share a commitment to what public life can achieve and the hope that government can be decent again. They reject the appeals to racism that have been Trump's calling card and the divisiveness at the heart of his electoral strategy. Together, they long for a politics focused on freedom, fairness, and the future. This new politics would be rooted in the economic justice that has always been the left's driving goal and in the problem-solving approach to government that moderates have long championed. It's true that these camps often battle over whether the nation should seek restoration or transformation in the years after Trump. In fact, our country needs both. To restore the democratic norms we have always valued, we must begin to heal the social and economic wounds that led to Trump's presidency in the first place. Yet there is resistance to common ground among progressives and moderates alike. They often mistrust each other's motives, battle fiercely over tactics, argue over how much change the country needs, and squabble over whether specific policy ideas go too far or not far enough. The moderate says, "Hey, progressive, you think that if you just lay out the boldest and most ambitious approach to any given problem, the people will rally to your side. Really? For one thing, people may like your objective, but think that you're changing things way more than we have to. And we can battle to the death over, say, a Democratic Party platform plank or the first draft of a bill. But without the hard negotiating and compromising that legislative politics requires, a bold idea will remain just a platform plank. That really doesn't do anyone any good. You subject everyone to so many litmus tests that we might as well be in chemistry class. And God save us from your abuse on Twitter if we disagree with you. You lefties have no idea how to win elections outside of Berkeley or Brooklyn, and some of your ideas are so sweeping that they will scare potential voters and allies away. At this point, the moderate is likely to wield the sturdy old punchline, "Don't let the perfect be the enemy of the good." But hold on, says the progressive. You moderates spend so much time negotiating with yourselves that you compromise away goals and priorities before the real battle even begins. Your ideas get so soggy and complicated that they mobilize no one and mostly put people to sleep. Better to have the courage of your convictions, lay out your hopes plainly and passionately, and inspire voters to join you. Besides, you middle-of-the-roaders were so petrified of Ronald Reagan and the right wing that you caved in to the Gipper's economic ideas, let inequality run wild, and gave us a racist and grossly unfair criminal justice system. The extremists have pulled the political center so far right that the only way back to sanity is to show our fellow citizens what a real progressive program looks like. At the risk of sounding like a perhaps unwelcome counselor attempting to ease a family quarrel, I would plead with moderates and progressives to listen to each other carefully. If the events since 2016 do not teach moderates and progressives that they must find ways of working together, nothing will. If they fail to heed each other's advice and take each other's concerns seriously, they will surrender the political system to an increasingly undemocratic right with no interest in any of their shared goals, priorities, and commitments. Moderates are right about the complexity of getting things done in a democracy. Even when the boldest ideas have prevailed, they did so because complex coalitions were built, important, and it should be said, often legitimate interests were accommodated, and some lesser goals were left by the wayside to be fought for another day. Moderates are also right that democracy requires persuading those who are open to change but worry about how this or that reform might work in practice or affect them personally. Think losing their private health insurance. Disdaining as sellouts those who raise inconvenient questions or express qualms is not the way to build a majority for reform. Moderates are also right that Americans in large numbers are tired of a politics that involves more yelling than dialogue, more demonizing than understanding. But progressives are right to say that for the last three decades, moderates have spent too much time negotiating with themselves. Consider all the effort Democrats put into wooing Republicans by responding to their proposals to amend Obamacare, only to have the GOP oppose it anyway and spend a decade trying to repeal it. Much the same happened with the 2010 Dodd-Frank Financial Services Reform Act. Moderates have too readily accepted the assumptions of their opponents, wasting energy and squandering opportunities by trying to accommodate a right wing that will never be appeased. Progressives are also right in saying that our political system tilts toward the wealthy and the connected. And whether they call themselves socialists or not, progressives have the intellectual high ground when they say that today's capitalism, a radical form of the market economy shaped in the 1980s that is quite different from earlier incarnations, is failing to serve the needs of Americans in very large numbers. As I hope is already clear, this book does not make the standard centrist argument that progressives can't win unless they become more moderate. But neither does it make a claim often heard among progressives that moderation is hopeless and the only way to prevail in a deeply divided country is to mobilize your own base. Each of these claims is incomplete. The problems with the first were underscored by the outcome of the 2016 election. Moderation alone does not guarantee victory, and the progressive critique of the center has become more persuasive as economic inequality has widened. The problem with the second is that every electoral contest involves both mobilization and persuasion. The important question is to establish where the balance between the two lies at any given moment. Neither can be ignored. Democrats certainly got that balance right in the 2018 elections. Moderates and progressives came together behind a remarkably diverse set of candidates, winning important governor's races in states that voted for Trump and taking control of the House. It was this victory that enabled House Speaker Nancy Pelosi to begin a formal impeachment inquiry after it was learned that Trump tried to enlist the Ukrainian government in an effort to smear former Vice President Joe Biden. A coalition for change produced a coalition for accountability. Maintaining and expanding this sense of unity, I will argue, requires a shared commitment to a set of goals and principles that I describe as a politics of remedy, a politics of dignity, and a politics of more. Remedy, solving problems, resolving disputes, moving forward, is the core purpose of democratic politics. Dignity is at the heart of demands for justice from long marginalized groups, as well as members of a once secure multiracial working class displaced by deindustrialization, trade, and technological change. And while moderates and progressives may differ on specifics, single-payer health care versus improvements on Obamacare, for example, they agree that energetic public action can provide more Americans with affordable health insurance, more with decent wages and benefits, more with family-friendly workplaces, more with good schools, more with affordable paths to college and effective training programs, more with unimpeded access to the ballot, more with adequate provision for retirement, more with security from gun violence. And yes, we need to do much more to combat climate change. But to forge the alliance American politics needs, moderates and progressives will have to abandon an unseemly moralism that feeds political superiority complexes. Progressives are not the impractical visionaries many moderates suspect them to be, with no concern for how programs work or how change happens. On the contrary, there are times when progressives are more practical than their critics in seeing that piecemeal reforms can be too narrow to solve the problem at hand, too stingy to create systems that inspire broad-based political support, and too accommodating to narrow interest groups. It should always be remembered that without the vision progressives offer, many reforms would never have been undertaken. The abolitionists agitated against slavery when most of the country was indifferent, opening the way for more moderate and cautious politicians such as Abraham Lincoln to end the nation's moral scourge. Laws regulating wages and hours were viewed as violations of property rights until they weren't. Racial equality was a radical demand until it became mainstream in the civil rights years. Gay marriage was opposed as recently as 2012 by a Democratic president. Progressives continue to broaden a political debate long hemmed in by the dominance of conservative assumptions and the stifling of progressive aspirations. Bernie Sanders moved single-payer health care onto the political agenda, giving the lie to the idea that Obamacare was socialist and radical. Elizabeth Warren has suggested far-reaching reforms to capitalism, proposing aggressive action against monopolies and a wealth tax that would directly address concentrations of economic power. Warren, Sanders, and their supporters have thus expanded our policy imaginations. Ideas once cast as leftist, an increase in the capital gains tax comes to mind, were suddenly seen as moderate alternatives. Moderates are not, as some progressives suspect, agents of influence for the status quo, seeking to channel reformist energy into safe pathways that leave the powerful undisturbed. Moderates are often as fed up with existing distributions of power and ways of doing business as are their friends to their left. But yes, moderates do counsel reformers to be on the lookout for the unintended consequences of their proposals. They hold out the hope that one step forward today can be followed by another step tomorrow, and they can point to Social Security and advances in health insurance coverage as examples of when modest first steps eventually led to more sweeping victories. Moderation itself embodies specific virtues that any democratic system needs. The political scientist Aurelien Créchu defines them well in his book, Faces of Moderation. He notes that moderation promotes social and political pluralism, has a propensity to seek conciliation and find balance between various ideas, interests, and groups, and does not assume that there is only one single correct or valid way of life on which we all might agree. Moderates recognize that most political and social issues often involve tough trade-offs and significant opportunity costs and require constant small-scale adjustments and gradual steps. Moderation is a form of opposition to extremism, fanaticism, and zealotry, teaches the virtues of self-restraint and humility, and seeks to keep the conversation open with friends, critics, and opponents. All these are habits and dispositions that progressives and humane conservatives know less than.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.